Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Pelagos channel. Well, today I've got a very special treat for you. It's been a very exciting day for me up to now, and this promises to be a very interesting day for the rest of everyone watching. I suggest that you do some research when you seen this video, and I would like to introduce to you the man of the hour, Wilco van Rooijen.
Good afternoon.
Hello.
Hello.
Well, first of all, thank you very much for being able to take some time to talk to me.
Yeah.
A little short, small YouTube channel.
Yes.
And
that's always nice to have a walk in nature.
So. Yes, we decided to go into nature. You'll probably see some nice...
Some Dutch nature.
Yeah, some Dutch nature. And Holland can be pretty.
Yes, it's flat, but it's pretty.
Yeah, definitely. I've seen some very nice parts of the country already. And today we're in Nederhorst den Berg.
Oh, yeah.
Which would translate something like Nederhorst den Mountain? The mountain?
Yeah, into the mountains, yeah.
Well, that's...
It's not really mountains, but it's just named after the mountains.
Yeah, they probably stole them or something happened to the mountains.
Or maybe a family name in the history.
I'm actually kind of a bit glad because I got a bit of... I'm a bit afraid of heights.
Ah.
not necessarily when it's nature. But when it's man-made, if I stand on a building, I'm not really sure.
Yeah.
But on a mountaintop or something, if I don't get too close to the edge,
I'll
be okay.
I'm always telling you, you have to look in front of you instead of downstairs, then it's not a problem.
Yeah.
Except when the building or the structure is moving, then I have also, you know, a little bit afraid. But after a while, you're getting used to it.
Yeah. Honestly, I've seen, of course, a lot of videos on YouTube, documentaries about what you all did.
Yeah.
Maybe you would like to give a short introduction about who is Wilco van Rooijen?
Yeah, I can. I'm Wilco, a mountaineer, adventurer, but beside of all, also a storyteller. So I'm writing books, giving a lot of presentations. That's how I can make a living out of my adventures. And of course, I try to, you know, imagine next projects, new projects.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's in the mountains, sometimes it's to the polar regions, but always adventure. And that's why you invited me as well. And
exactly.
This is also some kind of adventure.
Yes, exactly. Also, one of the reasons I really would like to talk to you is the inspirational source that you provide for other people who are stuck or don't think they are alive or they don't know what to do with their lives.
Yep.
I mean, you are someone who, because you call yourself a mountaineer, an adventurer.
Yeah.
But guys, if you have a look online, he's quite modest. He's been on three poles. The Everest, North and South Pole, even the geographical North Pole, was it?
Yes, both. Yeah.
Everest K2.
Without oxygen also.
Without oxygen three times, but one successful attempt.
Yep.
So it's not somebody who gives up easily.
No.
And maybe he can share some of the secrets of how not to give up easily. So, but how is it to mountain climb? Because I hear about extra oxygen on a mountain.
Yeah.
Would you consider that cheating or?
It's not, you know, my way of climbing, because you are fully depending on the technical system. And you know, from the old days I was a technician, and you know, here on sea level it's okay, you know, to use that, but if your life depends on it, I'm not I'm not believing in it, because you see that there are a lot of things going wrong. And finally, the sportive, you know, manner is, you know, to be dependent on yourself and not on the technical system. So if you can do it without, you know, for me it's more safe, and of course it's better, or you know, a more prestige thing to do.
It's like the battery in a quartz watch. or yeah. being actually the mechanical stuff doing it by its own in an automatic watch.
Yeah, it's you know, if your target is just to be on the summit, you know, and to say it doesn't matter how to, you know, how I come there, you can choose for bottled oxygen. But yeah, for me it was always the question, can I do it without it?
Yeah,
that's the most, you know.
Yeah, because science says it couldn't be done.
Yeah, exactly. And then my heart is beating faster because I'm asking myself, oh, if they say it can't, oh, I want to try it.
Let's prove them wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the first one to do it without oxygen summiting the Everest was Reinhold Messner, the Austrian.
Yeah, yeah.
And didn't he do it solo or?
No, the first time not. He was with Peter Habler, and that was really, you know, they had the guts to do it as the first human being, while the, you know, the medical institution or scientists said, no, that's not possible. People can't go at 9 kilometers altitude, you know, without bottled oxygen. And they showed it, you know, that it was possible. But for me, what makes it interesting is that you have the guts, you know, on one day that you say, hey, listen, I think it's possible, instead of all the others who are saying that that it isn't, and that you just do it.
Yeah.
And for me, it was also a big question. Am I capable, you know, of reaching the highest mountain of the world without bottled oxygen? And nobody can answer the question for you. And yeah, you just have to try it. And there's nobody who says to you, you know, you can also use bottled oxygen. But for me, it was always an really intense motivation, to try to do it without. And for me, it was already 10 years of my life before I reached that point, and still I'm very proud of that.
Yeah.
And I can say, if I didn't climb K2, for example, without bottled oxygen, I wouldn't have survived that expedition.
Why?
Because on the descent, a lot of things went wrong because our ropes were destroyed by an avalanche, and most of the climbers who were with bottled oxygen are not living anymore, just because of the simple fact that they were running out of oxygen. And when you're running out of oxygen and you're not used to that extreme high altitude, you make some mistakes, and then most of the time you won't reach base camp anymore.
Because that's what a lot of people think. You want to climb a mountain, you take a car, you get to the foot of the mountain, put your bottled oxygen, you go up, make a camp maybe halfway and go back. But an expedition is 2 to 3 months? Well, the actual expedition itself.
To the highest mountain, you know, for me, you need at least 3 months also to get mentally in shape, but also, you know, to adapt your body to that extreme altitude. And of course, you can do it in 5 or 6 weeks if you go with bottled oxygen. But then the question is, you know, do you really want to do it safe and on your own, you know, power and body? Or is the question that, you know, time is money and I have to go there and to go back as fast as possible.
And also probably when your oxygen runs out and you're on an altitude that your body's not accustomed to because you have been using that extra oxygen, you might get a big trouble
you get and become sick. Really, really big trouble. And you see it, for example, also in the movie, which is already an old story, but on Everest in 1996, you know, with the big tragedy, there were all people dying because, you know, they were running out of oxygen.
Right.
And of course you can say, oh, what a drama and what a big accident, but you can also ask the question, didn't these people know before, you know, that if you're climbing with oxygen and you're running out of time, you have a big problem.
It's also with going up the mountain without oxygen, like Reinhold Messner, the first one, and others to follow in his steps. Is that like similar to the 1 minute mile? That there was, the ones was a guy that they said you can't run a mile within a minute. There was one guy who did it. I'm not sure who did it, and it was like 60 or something. But he managed, and within a year, like 5 or 6 others ran the 1 minute mile.
That's unbelievable. And that's also my statement, you know, that if you can dream it, you can do it. And the question is, who of us all, you know, have the guts, you know, to imagine something new you know, and show it to the world, and then we can grow with the whole community. You know, not only in sports, but also you see it in, if you go to space, you know, of course in the beginning everybody is saying, ah, it's not possible to go to Mars or, you know, to the moon. And in the beginning, Mount Everest, it took longer to climb the Mount Everest than reaching the moon, for example.
Yeah.
But I think everything is possible, you know. There are no limitations or borders, or if you think about the, you know, the cosmos, everybody knows that there are no borders, you know.
Yeah.
But if you come back, you know, here on the ground, and people say, ah, listen, there are limitations and you can't do anything, you can't do everything.
Yeah.
But you can. It's just in your mind.
It's in the head.
It's in the head.
Yeah, that's one thing that I've been trying to tell people also a lot. Like, it's often a question of, I won't do it, when they say, I can't do it.
Exactly.
If somebody says, I can't do it, and you say, okay, I'll point the gun at your feet.
Exactly.
Are you going to do it? And say, yeah, now I'll do it. So you can dance, or you can sing, or you can climb a mountain if you want.
Exactly.
But you were just touching the 2008 expedition.
Yeah.
Now that had probably a very big impact.
Yes.
As a climber, as a person,
as a family man.
Is that, as a family man? Yes, of course. It's I read the book about it. Mm-hmm. I suggest everybody, if you can get a copy, read it. I'll show you a link where to get one. It was an expedition that went to up to K2, mm-hmm. and it developed some issues, some tragedy. But first there was the high. First there was the peak, the top, triumph.
Yeah.
Maybe you could.
Elaborate a little bit. It was, you know, K2 is a really, you know, difficult and special mountain. You know, it's you can't compare it with Mount Everest, for example. And Mount Everest, it's climbed by 4,000, maybe 5,000 people right now. You know, most of the people buy bottled oxygen, but anyhow, K2 was not climbed by 300 people. You know, and if you read the statistics, 1 in 4 is not surviving this mountain.
Incredible.
So you can ask the question, or you must be crazy, or you must really rely on your team, you know, and believe that you together you can do it.
Well, if you go up with 8 people in
exactly.
percentage, that
exactly.
means
exactly that means that you
lose
are losing
two.
Exactly. And but I was, you know, my first experience on K2 is a long time ago, 1995. I was a young climber, but I got the opportunity, and of course, you know, if you're young, you go for it. But then, after my first accident on K2, rock fall on my face, bone was broken, arm was broken, lost 1.5 liter of blood.
Yeah, on the mountain.
On the mountain. So, you know, it was a really scary situation.
Yes.
And, you know, I was lucky that I had the right kind of team members around me, so I survived. And then I thought, okay, this mountain is really a mountain too high, and that's why I, you know, focused on Mount Everest and all the mountains, the 7 summits and the poles, and Cho-Oyu, Broad Peak, all the 8,000 meters peak. But after a while, when I was done, you know, with this climbing of Mount Everest and the other mountains, it was still, you know,
splinter in the mind,
back on my mind.
Yeah.
And I thought, okay, I think I'm ready to go again. And it was in 2006. But
right, 2 years.
I had not so much time for the preparation because I had also a marriage to go. So I thought, let's see on the internet. Let's see if I can find some international climbers. We share, you know, the costs, and we go to K2. But of course, we didn't reach the summit because we weren't really a team. You know, we were a group of people, but not a real team. So
less preparation.
Less preparation. We were not, you know, ready to go for each other. You know, in fixing the camps. You know, and push harder because we had all our own agenda. You know, I want to go to the summit, and if the other guys hopefully go tomorrow to camp 3, maybe I can go the day after tomorrow to camp 4. You know, so finally I came back, and the positive thing was that I met some really nice international climbers, and like Gerard McDonnell, like Dawa, some Sherpas as well.
Yeah.
Which are really trusted. And so I asked them actually, listen, if we would go back to K2 again, would you join me? And Gerard McDonnell was the first one who said, yes, this is my big dream.
It was the Irish climber.
And if we can organize this expedition, I will be part of it.
Yeah.
So then came the expedition in 2008, and we had a hell of a team, 8 climbers.
Yeah.
Three older, experienced Dutch climbers who climbed at 8,000 meters in the years before. 2 younger guys like myself in 95. And finally, I found also 3 other strong climbers, one from Australia, from Ireland, Jer, and Pemba. And,
Pemba was the Sherpa, yeah?
Was a Sherpa, but we were all equal in the team. Nobody was a Sherpa like the style that he was, bringing up the stuff for us. We were all climbing, in equal teams to get higher on the mountain. And finally, we had also a really ambitious route. It's called the Seisenhoed instead of the normal Abruzzi ridge.
Uh-huh.
So we were actually the only climbers on this route, which was actually, they had been climbed once.
Only once.
Oh, wow. And it was never, climbed before. So for us, it was also a big risk. But we were really thinking this is a more safety route instead of the Abruzzi ridge, because I had an accident in 95 on this ridge. Gerard McDonnell had an accident in 2006. So we were really finding another route which was more safe for us. And then finally, after a long time hard working, we were waiting for the right kind of weather window, and actually the good weather was not coming in. So there were a lot of teams, they were actually saying, we are leaving the mountain, it's not possible this year.
Yeah.
And then we were keep on going, keep on trying, still keep believe, it can be done. So, it's just a matter of patience.
Yeah.
And then really, really, really at the end of the season, actually, at the end of July, my weather forecast man predicted the weather window, which was really long, 4-5 days. And that was the last chance, the last opportunity in that season. And of course, you bring the news into all the base camps, hey, listen, there is a last opportunity.
There is a window.
There is a window. So everybody was, moving in and said, okay, listen, then we have to work together. So we make more chance, in reaching the summit of K2, which is really, really special. Because Mount Everest, the summit is reached every year, approximately.
Yeah.
But K2, there are years it's not been climbed.
Yeah, I read that after 2008, there wasn't one in 9 and 10.
Exactly. And in 11, only 2.
All right.
So that's something completely different. And finally, we said, okay, let's work together. So we made the plan. Share the workload between the Italians, between the Norwegian, the American, everybody who was on the mountain, Korean team as well.
Oh yes, yeah, I remember that.
And we went up, and of course we had some problems in the beginning, in fixing ropes and run out of ropes, etc. But finally, it took a little bit longer, but after 17 hours of climbing, we reached the summit of K2. And we were really so happy, because it was the most beautiful weather. We could, make a phone call by the satellite, without gloves. And we were dancing, and, you saw the horizon, the bending of the horizon, so.
The top of the K2 over the horizon.
Yes, so it makes gorgeous. You so small, and on the other hand, so proud, what you have done, what you have achieved with your team. And then
how long were you climbing when you reached the top? How long had you been climbing? 17 hours, you said?
Yes, from camp 4, 17 hours.
Oh.
So it took much longer than we expected. But on K2 it's now or nothing,
Yeah.
And if you keep too easily on the safe side. You know, you say, hey, listen, we're a little bit more hours, along the track. Maybe we should go back. Of course, you can make the decision. But K2, you know, if the snow is knee deep or waist deep,
yeah,
you know, that makes a difference of many hours.
Yeah.
So we had to fight for every meter. You know, there was a lot of snow, and you know, in fixing the ropes, because that's something you can say, okay, we're not fixing ropes, so we are quicker, so we can move fast. Right. On the way back, you have a problem.
Okay, that's where all. Now we turned around. Yeah. So yeah, you got a problem.
Yeah, we turn around. So on the summit, we turn also
exactly
around.
Exactly. And sorry, guys, look at this view here. Look at that. Holland can be beautiful. We said so. We're not lying. Anyway, sorry, mate. Continue.
Yes. We turned around, and you know, we were on the way back. And of course, you know, we had our radio conversations, you know, with our base camp. Be careful, and we say, that's not a problem, because the ropes are there.
Yeah.
It's just a matter of, you know, going back to the last ropes, clicking into the lines, follow the lines, and probably 1:30 in the night, we would give Roger, you know, we are safe and sound in Camp 4.
Yeah. So you've been up for 24 hours. That will be like the goal.
Yes.
Climb
yes.
for 24 hours, go up and back.
Yeah, maybe a little bit more than 24 hours, but you know, that's not a problem. You have your hair torch, and if you are really, you know, be careful, slow down, you know, they're not in a hurry, it's still brilliant weather.
Yeah.
So be sure that you are in control.
Yeah.
Now, so we went down, but then there was a big surprise. We couldn't find our ropes anymore. And that's really strange, because
so you're on top on a mountain, you want to go down, and the ropes are gone.
Gone, you know, and it's just 15 minutes down, and your ropes are not there. You think, how is this possible?
Right,
of course, you know.
They must be here.
They must be here. So you start discussion, and then someone say, hey, listen, we have to go more to the right, or we have to go more to the left. But then you go there, and there are also not the ropes.
Nothing, yeah.
And then the problem starts, because the people don't trust the plan anymore. They say, you can tell me a lot more, but I'm going over there, because I'm sure it must be there.
Yeah.
So the team split up, and not my team actually, but you know, all the others. So suddenly you are just with a few climbers left. And finally, when we couldn't find the ropes, Gerard McDonnell, me and Marco, Italian mountain guide, they said, listen, we have to make a bivouac, because you know, tomorrow if the sun is rising, we have the view, we are a little bit, you know, recuperated, we have more energy, and we can hopefully find the ropes again. And we were really not in a panic yet, you know, so we said, okay, it's better to rest now, not to push the limits, because then we make a mistake and we fall down.
So we make
a bivouac. And of course, you know, it was a hard way, because a bivouac sounds very romantic. But the only thing you do is you sit in the snow, you know, you wait together, waiting for the sun is rising.
Because
you
know, the temperature was like
minus 30.
Right, minus 30.
Without food, without drinking, you know.
That would be considered okay weather at night on K2, or?
Yes, of course. And
if it would have been worse, then.
If the weather wasn't that good, we would have, you know,
and a story.
Yeah, we didn't make any chance. You know, when the wind is blowing over there, you're blowing off the mountain, and it's finished. Yeah. Like it was in '86, for example, on K2, also a big tragedy. But we were waiting. Next morning, we survived, and then we start looking again all over the place, and. Then the panic was starting, because we couldn't find the rope again.
Yeah.
And I made another mistake. I was moving my glasses a little bit too much, because I was thinking I can see it better, you know, far away. And I got snow blindness. I knew, okay, now it's be or not to be. So I hadn't any discussion anymore. I just went down, because I knew there is nobody who can help me, you know, if my eyes are really 100% snowblind.
Yeah.
So I went down, and actually it's logical But finally, you can't go down anymore because on K2 it's not a path like this, you know. Suddenly,
there
is a black hole.
You have a drop, or
yes. And what are you going to do then?
Yeah.
People say, yeah, you go back to the last point, but there is no energy anymore. You're completely exhausted, empty. So there was no option to the left, no option to the right. So actually, my life was ended. And that was the first time that I made a telephone call at home to my wife, who was sitting at home with a child of 7 months. And of course, by the media, she heard all the dreadful stories, you know, that people were killed on K2 and vanished.
Media.
Yeah. And then, there's something interesting happened, because we weren't angry at each other. And she was actually giving me strength by saying, listen, you have to keep on going because of your son, you know, and we are sending you the energy, and please keep on going, etc., etc. And I said, of course I'm keep on going, but the strange thing was, after the telephone call, I felt unconscious, my energy was lost, you know, and of course I knew that I must be awake, you know, and I couldn't fall asleep. But if you are so tired, your eyes are just falling down and you are sleeping.
Check if it's still running, because I don't want to miss a thing. Yeah, it is.
But if you fell down at that altitude, you know, without any energy anymore left in your system, actually it's done, you know.
Yeah.
And it's you don't feel the pain anymore. You just, you know, fall asleep and you never wake up again.
Right, yeah.
But a strange thing happened. After half an hour, I woke up again. And that's an interesting, you know, part of the story, because
that doesn't happen too often.
Of course, because sometimes I compare it with, if you are really drunk, you fall asleep, and the next morning you wake up because there is a lot of oxygen,
and
there is new energy, and then you think, why am I not lying in my bed? And I was on that mountain, I fall asleep, but I can't, you know, I couldn't get the energy back because there is no oxygen in the air. So something gave me the trigger. And my story, my belief is that my son was giving me this. But anyhow, I opened my eyes, but there was still no solution. It was still this black hole. But finally, there was an avalanche gully, which you're normally not using because of the avalanche danger.
Uh-huh.
But this time I thought it's all or nothing. So I tried this gully. And there was a big chance, you know, in falling down through this gully, 2,000 meters, you know, back to base camp. But finally, I was successful in going down in this gully, really slowly. And when I was finished with this gully, it was already 7:30 in the evening again.
Wow.
So I had to make
another
bivouac. And I knew, you know, that I had to do this. Because otherwise, you know, I was maybe ending in a crevasse or whatever. Mm-hmm. I didn't have a hair torch anymore, no backpack, I left everything. So I made that other bivouac as well, and I thought, I don't know if I, you know, surviving this night, because 7:30 in the night till 5 o'clock, till 5 o'clock in the next morning, it's a long night.
Oh,
and
yes.
And you have still no energy, no food,
no
water, minus 30. So
the time slows down, probably.
And you don't look at your watch anymore because you're getting frustrated. The time is going that slow that you can't think, another 5-6 hours and it will go on again. You think, another 5-6 hours, I fall asleep again. And it's finished.
So the only concentration is on
your fully, you know,
your body,
backing
your mind,
yourself,
like in a trance.
Yes, and I believe that, you know, then maybe the cosmic energy, you know, is coming to you or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, I made maybe connection with my son. I can't tell you, but I was really
very well possible.
You know, concentrated and focused that this couldn't be the end of my life. You know, I had to go back. I had to take care of my son, etc., etc.
You didn't.
And finally, the next morning, I saw the sun was rising again, and you know, I thought, okay, now I have to go on. And I went on, and then at 10 o'clock in the morning, I never forget. I saw in far away some orange spot and I thought, hey, that looked like tents. And I thought, hey, what are these tents doing on this mountain? You know, I was really completely, you know, far away. And I went to the these tents, and then I saw my companion Cass. He was still waiting for me.
His eyes must have been this size.
Yeah, we fall into each other's arms and we start crying.
Of course, yeah.
You know, wow. And then it took a long time, 10:30 in the night. We reached base camp, but you know, it's. And then I heard all the stories, what happened with all the other climbers, especially with my teammate, Gerard McDonnell, who tried to reach other climbers. I've seen those guys hanging. I had to be, you know, honest in saying that I made the choice, you know, in passing these guys, because I was feeling, you know, that I really couldn't do anything for them. But he had the guts, you know, to give them help, try to release the lines where they are hanging on.
Yeah.
And finally, we know by radio conversations that in a second and a third avalanche, you know, Gerard McDonnell was swept away as the climbers he, you know, released. So it's you know, you can't hardly believe the whole story.
Exactly, that's what I often said, that reality is often more weird than fiction.
Yes, that's what I've always said. If I wrote, of course I wrote a book, but if you didn't knew that it was reality, exactly, you know, non-fiction,
sure,
you wouldn't believe it. It's too much in one story on one mountain.
Absolutely. I've also saw the documentary about two guys, two friends who went to Peru.
Yes.
And
yes,
one guy fell into a crevasse,
yes,
or into a gletscher.
Yeah.
And he couldn't get out up.
Yeah.
So he lowered himself,
yes,
into the gletscher,
yes,
and
yeah,
came out on another way.
Yeah, lowered. Companion, he cut the line.
Yeah,
you
yeah,
know,
because
and he fell down.
Yeah. But he had like a broken leg and
yeah,
everything, and he got himself
yeah,
off the mountain.
Yeah.
It's just.
Yeah,
the ability of the human spirit and body is just incredible.
It's amazing, yes. And this story, I have been thinking about this story also in this crisis moment. You know, I thought, listen, there were miracles in the past. You know, so a miracle must be happening right now again. You know,
that's one of the reasons I'm so glad I'll be able to have this conversation, just to let people know. You know, if things get stuck. And you decide to say, no, I will not accept my situation, in a way that you say, yes, I'm going to act on it now.
Yes.
Then you are able to do things you never dreamt of.
Yes.
And that is something that's...
And of course, you know, it's not a guarantee, you know, because people are telling me, yeah, but maybe you were also being left on the mountain, you know. Yeah, that was a possibility.
Yeah.
But in both ways, it's hard to believe, but in both ways it was okay. Of course, I'm dreaming of you know, becoming a guy who is 100 years old. But nobody, approximately, of us is becoming 100.
No,
so
sure.
The question is, what are you going to do, you know, between these years? And of course, you know, it's still really painful, you know, if you're losing a companion, a teammate, a
that
beloved
is.
Person like Gerard.
Because it's also a person that you
yes.
relied on with your
yes.
life.
Yes.
It's not just a neighbor or a friend,
no,
it's somebody
no.
you trusted 110%.
It's like a brother, it's family, you know,
exactly.
And that's why it's how it's worked also, you know, that his family is become my family, you know, because every date, every year, the 1st of August, there are burning lights, you know, we are in contact again, not only, you know, who are left here, but also with Jer, you know, and that's why he is not away or not dead for me.
Yeah, true.
And he's still giving me the energy and try to, you know, to remember, you know, his life.
He's there.
And to get the energy from that, you know, that we have to live our lives like he did.
Exactly.
You know, and need the guts, you know, not in walking away from, you know, problems or challenges, but just face them, and go for it. That was his dream, that's what he did, and he lived his life fully.
And will people, sometimes you seem to be able also to force luck in a sense that if you go in a direction you really want, mm-hmm. and you keep going that way, it's like nature aligns a lot of the stuff to get handled for you. You know, if you need one extra ticket on the plane, but you have everything arranged, there's a big chance that when you get to the airport, there's suddenly an extra space on the plane.
Yes, yes.
And
that's also what I'm stronger believe day by day, you know, that we can't control systems, you know, but that you have, sometimes you have to let it go, you know, and you know, the answer is there, you know?
Yeah, exactly. But in Holland, you might know, is in Holland it's not very fashionable to say, I believe in something extra than
exactly.
earth we walk on.
Yeah, they say if you can't measure, it doesn't exist. Yeah, but that's bullshit.
Well, like electricity, right?
Yeah.
But no, but that's interesting. What I about to ask about this, because it's actually kind of an interesting topic.
Yeah.
Because in Holland it's very fashionable to be against a lot of things, the complaining,
yeah.
but especially the church and everything, they're yeah. wrong, they did everything wrong.
Yeah.
But what I'm really interested in is when I see people who did extraordinary things, mm-hmm. like you did on K2 or Everest or wherever you went, yeah. or the project you're working on now,
yeah.
They tend to change their views into more feeling like blessed or fortunate to be able to do the things they did in life and are thankful,
yeah,
and not complaining. Like I think you said in an interview, there's a lot of people who want to sail around the world in a sailboat,
yeah,
but when you zoom in, they actually don't want to.
No. I'm always asking the guys who said, you are easy talking, but if I explain to my wife that I want to go sailing, I'm sure that she will say, no, that's not the plan. But then I'm asking, did you really have asked this question to your wife once in your life? And of course it's the answer, no.
Did you choose the right wife?
Yeah, also.
For your life you're leading. I mean,
I
your wife probably has to
if
deal.
If somebody is really loving you,
yeah.
and it's not, you know, from today on tomorrow,
gotta
but
let
really
go.
have a dream, you know, which you share, then you try to find the right kind of people who are believing in this dream, finally it will happen.
Yeah.
But the question is, do you have to focus on this long-term, you know, dreams? Because I can also easy, after a couple of beers, saying, hey, listen, let's sail to the Antarctic. It's not working like that.
No,
you know? But then, of course, my wife will say, you're
crazy.
You know? Yeah.
Let me just check the battery. It's going well.
Ja, ratio en onverklaarbare zaken, weet je wel. En dat daar eigenlijk zo'n, ja, nog zo'n wereld ligt waar we zoveel zouden kunnen hebben.
Ja, so, it's more or less like a kind of a Buddhistic thinking of, you know, we're all one.
Absolutely.
We're all connected to each other.
Yeah.
And
yeah. I was telling, you know, with my son, you know, he mm-hmm. was a quiet baby, and my wife was telling me later on, when I was, you know, on the mountain, mist on the mountain, you know, on my second night or whatever, my boy was really, you know, screaming. And she was telling me later, it seems he was, you know, saying goodbye to you or something, you know,
right,
because
yeah.
it was not normal what he did right then.
He was just
and I
off.
Think that was the moment that I was, you know, waking up.
All right, he was waking you up.
Yes, and
very well possible.
You know,
yeah.
if you are reading about, you know, quantum mechanics or,
yeah.
or you know, there, you know, about energy and photons, you know, who are dancing, you know, all over the world. We are
yeah.
connected, you know. We are connected with nature, but also with materials, you know.
Well, in a sense, it's always. I heard somebody saying, like, okay, let's say that this is all like a coincidence. Then it's a pretty well built up coincidence.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
if you would put a lot of junk in your backyard, you wouldn't expect within a few billion years to have it on Earth with oxygen and living people. And
yeah.
it's like the life is in the rocks.
Yeah.
It is there.
Yeah.
It will
yeah.
always go. And it's an astonishing thing. And we probably don't know anything
yeah.
above our own perception, we forget every time we die or whatever happens. But I believe if we die, we get this sudden realization, oh, this is it. Oh, now I know how it is. So your whole life you're thinking about what happens. And when it happens, it's just like falling asleep and you wake up in your new life kind of like, I knew this all the time. How could I be so stupid to think that there's nothing? There is
There's everything.
There's only everything.
You don't need anything actually, but you know, it's
And that's what I really enjoy when people who have seen the world, who are entrepreneurs, mountaineers, went through big disasters, tragedies and triumphs, and they telling the world, don't be such a negative atheist. Not don't want to have any dead horses in my bed, but yeah, it's you suddenly realize a sort of how do you say a blessing, of what you could do.
I think the older you become, the less, you know, big symbolic challenges you need, because you are more vulnerable, you know, about the nature around you, and you know that we can breathe, you know, and if you have experiments.
Yeah, ik had deze ook nooit zelf gekocht, hoor.
If you have experiments, you know, the lack of oxygen. I it's another story. I remember when my father was, you know, he has cancer, and in 5 months he passed away.
Right.
And you know, he was on some kind of technical system, you know, which was giving him the pressure, you know, this
and what it looks like. Yeah.
And he was asking me the question, how does it feel, you know, at Mount Everest or K2 without, you know, with a lack of oxygen? I said, Daddy, the fight you have to make right now, you know, it's much harder than I have done, you know, in my life. You can't compare it. It's from a complete other perspective, you know. And that's sometimes we think, oh, I'm not lucky. I have to, you know, my life is not so easy. I'm financial not so rich or whatever, you know. But we are rich, you know. We are unbelievable rich.
So we got clean water out of the tap, you're rich.
And as long as we are healthy, you know, it's, and we can't control that with all our medical systems you know, it's just
you can also debate if it's okay that everyone has to be kept alive as long as possible, you know, with all kinds of lines and tugs in his head and his shoulder and his mouth and his nose, and just to keep him alive for one more day. And that's what is a trend that a lot of people say, I'm not going to go through agony. I'm no pope. I will just go when I feel like it. And you know, You didn't, as far as we know, we didn't choose life.
Yeah, yeah.
So you might have a choice in saying, well, I don't want to suffer at the end. But that's a different story.
And you have a choice, you know, make something of your life or not. But do not complain, you know, because complaining,
don't
you know,
complain.
Especially in a rich country as the Netherlands, you know.
Yeah, there are always, enough, you know, possibilities.
They're always, you know, looking to other people's, they do it wrong, or he has to do that, or he has to do that.
Yeah.
Look at yourself, you know, if you're pointing to somebody else, there are always three things pointing to yourself. You know?
Guilty though.
And that's also on the mountain. You can't blame anyone on the mountain, you know, except yourself. And you're always losing from nature. Nature is always stronger. So, you know, realize that you are only for 3 seconds on this earth, you know, and this mountain is there maybe 300 million years, hopefully.
Also, everybody should realize that you have so much more power than you think you have. And
everybody,
and, exactly.
From
everybody.
Small to big, and from, you know, it's everybody, every, you know, have a strong system who can achieve even more than he thinks, you know. But
and not
saying,
not even that little more, but like 3, 4, 5, 6 times more.
Mind blowing, you know. Yeah. Worldwide, we can be a game changer, you know.
They sometimes
the
say
only
that
thing is, do we really want it?
You know, they sometimes say if you go, for example, you're gonna run, and the moment you feel like, oh, I can't, I'm done, then you stop.
Yeah.
And in the army, they train you to run twice as long and twice as fast and twice as far. But when it's for your life, you can do it even twice as long as in the army.
Yeah. The bottleneck is in our mind, you know, not in our, you know, system. You know, if we can really, you know, focus, you know, and inspire each other, you know, we are, I think, the only species, you know, who can solve all the problems in the world.
Yeah, and it's a mindset.
Yes.
And that's what I really like about your new project.
Yep.
Is it's all about making it like a normal way of living.
Exactly.
Being conscious of nature instead of looking at the dangers and making people afraid and start with the schools and start. What is the latest project?
The latest project is actually that we want to join or to show that we have to be really circular in thinking. And what I mean is that nature around us is circular, you know, everything is born again, you know, in springtime, and you know, it go away, you know, in autumn, and it comes again. But
cycles.
If we look at our, you know, stuff, technology, it's always linear designed, you know. So that means that if we make something, you buy it and it's almost broken down and you throw it away, and we have some chemical stuff,
consumer,
you know, which is
society,
and spoiling ourselves, because nature will survive, no problem.
We got it wrong so far that it's often cheaper to replace a product than to repair it.
Exactly. And then we say, yeah, but the oil is that cheap, you know, it doesn't make sense, you know, to make something, recycle something from plastic, because it's cheaper to make it from oil, you know, brand new.
Yeah.
It's such a bullshit. And that's what we try to show in this project, that we make, you know, from our plastic behavior, actually, you know, all the things we buy from plastic, we will recycle it, you know, and give it a new life. We are building a future, a car, you know, of recycled materials,
right?
And this car is driving on solar energy, the power of nature, to the end of the world, the Antarctic, the South Pole. And you show that this car, you know, can keep driving forever, because it's driven by solar energy.
So it can drive on Antarctica. Doesn't mean the temperature doesn't have any effect on the solar panel.
That's a good statement. Some people say, that's not possible, it's too cold, minus 30. We show it is possible. Yeah. It's not the problem of technology. The technology is there. The only question is, are we really wanted to do this?
People need proof.
If you have shown it, or I see it in my project right now, people say, brilliant project, and of course we're joining you, because you are not asking money. No, we're not asking money. We're just asking, do you really want to do something different? Instead of throwing things away, give it to the expedition, and we build a new, you know, shape from it, a car. And so then said, are you really, you know, building a car of plastics, which we normally burn? Yes.
Yeah. Because anybody who knows the smell of burnt plastic knows it's quite toxic. There wouldn't be the first fireman to go into a hospital when he goes into a fire. It's not often the fire that hurts them, but the smoke and the toxic things that get burnt like plastic.
Exactly. And also, you know, the whole emissions, you know, what you are talking, because climate, you know, temperature is rising because of this, you know, gas we are, you know.
Yeah, just filling the air.
Filling the air, then stop burning all those waste, you know, and use this waste in making it a circular economy.
Yeah.
And if you start with children, they don't ask why, they say, wow.
One second, that way is
they say, wow, let's do it. That's what we are doing now. So we are, with the waste they collected by 3D printing, we make new parts, and these parts we click it together. Actually, that's the body of the car,
right?
And if they print the small part, they print also a message on the hexagon, that's the
hexagon
shape. And this message is actually the message they have for us, you know. For example, why don't we use recycling, or why are
message
we using world. Still fossil energy, you know, all these questions. And if we reach the South Pole in January 2018, then their message is on the car, you know, on the South Pole.
That's great.
And they wrote history, you know, in just collecting
trash. So, what's the website name to go
the
and
website
look for?
Website name is www.clean2antarctica.com or .nl.
So it's www.clean2antarctica.com. Excellent. Have a look. I'll put the links, all the links downstairs on this video. So.
And we show another video from this expedition, so you will really get the picture of this expedition.
Yeah, it's gonna be very, very interesting. I'll keep monitoring it, and who knows, maybe in the future there will be some follow-up that I can actually film the car for you guys and have a look what is all the things going on. And you know, Antarctica, it's not the first place anybody would go to.
No,
but
most extreme environment you can imagine.
I think to say a quote that every mountaineer knows, but probably you don't. When somebody asked one of the first guys who attempted to climb Everest, he said, "Why on earth would you climb Everest, Mr. Mallory?" And he said, "Simply because it's there." And I think that's the best thing to think about.
Shortest answer.
Well, this was a little bit of a walk we had.
Yeah.
I would like to thank you very, very much. Just have a quick look at the watch, because he's got a, let me see if I can get it in. There you go, a Rolex Explorer 2. And that watch has been all over the world. Now, I know you guys were gonna have a ball with me for being kind of critical about Rolex. Honestly, even have a Facebook
page.
But I
give this watch to my son, and exactly. Who can tell, you know, that you are giving your watch to your son, because you really still believe that in 100 year times it's still running.
And that's why you buy a real watch. We didn't get it to this interview, but you said as well, like, if you take all kinds of mountain watches onto a mountain,
always problems with batteries and plastic stuff, and you know, losing the figures around it and etc.
Actually not a good thing.
And when you need it hard, it must be working.
So guys, you gotta hear it from me now. It started to rain. I think it's a great time to to move. Although
it's Dutch, eh?
Well, yeah. You know what am I saying? I'm talking with a mountaineer. He's not going to be afraid of a bit of rain.
No.
But anyway, guys, thanks for watching, and Wilco, thanks again a million.
And good luck with your YouTube channel.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Ciao, di bye.